pump, maybe we can start that pump, and a pump's all in a small hole, and we can get a film of oil between the thrust pad and the thrust block. And once we've got that film of oil all the way around the machine, when we do a maintenance, these floor covers are all standing on or off. We can have one person on one side of the rotor, one person on the other side pushing against the beams and hold the floor there. We can actually turn the machine by hand. It just turns around just enough to sort of to move it around, just to line different things up for measurements or for whatever. But we've got the building, the whole system, the whole setup weighs about 70 tons. And if you just turn it around with two people, just pushing it.
It's
pretty
friction.
Floating.
That oil weighs up.
That's all it works on.
Cooling water system, we use a fair bit of cooling water. Inside the alternator there's radiators, much the same as in the car, except they work in reverse. We put cold water through the tubes, the coolers, and the fins that are on the coolers. All the hot air from the generator comes out through the fins, and it's the air that's cooled by the cool water. Both bearings have got internal, or one bearing's got an internal cooler that sits inside the oil. The other bearing's got two external coolers that stand around the outside of the machine. And there's oil pipes that go out to those, and just through convection, as in hot oil rises, as the oil is cooled, the oil goes to the bottom, goes back into the bearing pot, and so the hot oil comes in the top of the coolers, and it just self-pumps around the bearing and cools the oil on that way. Transformer out the backyard's got two coolers on it as well. Machine governor system uses pressurised oil. There's a sump and a governor set up over the back there. You see when you go downstairs, that's got two pumps on it. The two pumps run, pump oil up into what we call accumulators. They've got pressure nitrogen on the top and oil underneath. And that's what holds the oil at pressure. You have the pressurised nitrogen there. And that oil is what's used to open and close the guide vanes and vary the pitch on the blades. Behind you there, you can see those two black pipes coming up through the core to the centre of the machine there. The small round part on top of the machine, the white piece, there's a piston inside that, and the oil in those two pipes goes into our piston and pushes the piston up and down, and there's a shaft that goes down through the centre of the machine, and that's what connects on the linkages and varies the pitch of the blades on the runner setup in the pipes. And that's where
so
the control
out, yeah.
On. There's only four units here, the PLC program and module controllers. They're all input and output units for the PLC controls. Basically, the output units, if the cooling water mount downstairs is part of the terminal, there'll be a light come on with an output unit and a change, it's a signal from the computer signal basically to the monitor. So the valve opens and there's feedback sensors on the valves, there are proximity probes and switches, different dimensions of this. And as the signal comes back from the valve, back up and there'll be another light come on another device. So basically the computer knows it's told something to do something and then it looks for the feedback to come back as it goes so that it knows that it has changed state. The last panel of the machine is the controls. That thing there, that's basically the computer, that's the brain, that's got the program, that's what's set up the control of the whole power station. There's one of those in the governor panel as well as the exaltation panel, that they get their signal from that one, and that's basically what talks the robot, that's what the robot talks to, until it starts to stop and to load up. Program sits in that, it's basically just an SD card that sits in that. And
okay, I'll add more stuff in this.
In a nutshell, that operates. The PLC system does a lot of control, a lot of the tripping for the machine or the protection. When they designed this lot, they decided they didn't trust PLCs. A lot of the protection. Pressure, level, flow, depending on whatever it is that's looking at, if it's a bearing or whatever it is, whether it's a state of temperature and level of settings in them. And if any of those reach in, if any of those settings get up first, there'll be an alarm that's generated by that controller, because it's the controller looks at all this stuff and knows what's going on. There'll be an alarm generated by the controller. But if the pressure or the temperature or whatever it is gets to a trip point, the machine will trip itself through its through protection circuitry, independent of the PLC. So if the PLC fails, the machine's still capable of shutting itself down, getting itself back to a shutdown state. Anyone got any questions? What there is up the lake, there
just start dropping plastic bags in the intake.
Don't you have little person glasses?
Yeah. Sticking to the wall at present time. 188 revs a second, we can see that shaft going around. Last time we did tours, it was running, so I could only really take people to the doorway until the time it was safe to sort of bring people in there. If the machine does start, we will go out in order to fly at order of fashion, but I think it's fairly unlikely to start in the water that we don't get. So they told you how much water the machine used upstairs today, filling in on that sort of stuff. A lot, the correct answer. 106,000 litres a second, right answer. 106 tonnes a second. Or an Olympic swimming pool every 24 seconds. Every second. It's a high volume, low pressure machine, and that's the design of these adjustable propeller blades on the bottom of it to adjust for high efficiency. Above us, we've got the stator and the rotor, which is the high part of that silver shaft. So the rotor, which spins inside, it's got 32 DC energized magnets to it. And it rotates at 188 revs a minute, which produces our launches. And so basically, as we learn at school, the magnet running inside a coil produces electricity, water in, water out, is exactly right, but it uses a hell of a lot of stuff in between to keep it safe, keep it operating, and to monitor it. We've got about 180 tonnes of thrust on that shaft wanting to go downwards. So above here we've got what we call a thrust bearing, which is a big segmented pad bearing, 16 pieces to it. It sits in an oil bath, and it doesn't make contact with the other steel surface. The oil is actually in between the two surfaces to create an oil wedge. So it floats on an oil wedge. Just a few microns thick. When we start the machine, we actually, in the start sequence, we have an oil injection pump, and there's little holes and pipes connected to those pads, and they actually lift the machine by about 0.15 of a millimetre, and that allows the oil to get underneath it. And once that happens, I could probably turn the machine itself. So it's very, very frictionless in that state. Once the water comes onto the machine, it's probably up and running in about 4 seconds from 0 to 188. We've got 106 tons of force falling on those blades. It just gets it going without too much pressure. The way the water gets on the machine is outside this wall. We've got what we call a spiral, which holds our high pressure water from the dam. That's open to these series of round pots here. Now we've got a series of like vertical blinds all the way around there. Underneath this, that's completely closed by a series of steel paddles called, what I call them vertical blinds, but they're actually guide vanes. So when they open up, the water rushes through. Now they open up with these servo motors, give a command, and they move that ring about 300 millimetres. Then off that ring there's these levers. The levers move, rotate, all of those at the same time, and they actually open the guide vanes up, and that's when the water pours through and starts the machine. So they're controlled to certain positions that they can and can't open to control the load. So the machine. They're all in, well, the regular rings always push to the same direction. Yep. And the guide vanes just rotate one way, they pull back and they just rotate the other way. So very, very common theme, the guide vanes. Different way to do it in this one. It's got about, what was it, four or five servo motors on this one. We've got to make sure they're all in sync together, otherwise, you know, Arthur's not talking to Martha's, he's not talking to George properly. You only need a little bit of out of sync and you can create a few problems for yourself. Other big machines just have two, they just have like a steam train arrangement, just two rods pushing and pulling that big ring around. If we get something jamming between the guide vanes when they close, we've got these centre pins, these silver ones here, they're aluminium. They will break at a certain load, so we don't do any damage to ourselves. The hydraulics don't keep trying to close that one when it's actually got a branch or something jamming between it. That can come through the headworks, even though we've got rates and screens there. We clean the screens, but sometimes in the act of breaking, more debris comes through and it can just catch on those guide mains. And then when they go to close, they pinch, they won't pinch closed. So we just have to replace those, and if it continues to break, we've got to drain that spiral and investigate. So all that water happens a couple of metres below us,